just before we start, Charles, just get the things right. So you were born in Yorkshire in 1918.
Yeah.
You're not actually Irish. Not really.
No.
No. And then you were training as a compositor when you were called up.
Yes.
In 1939. And then you did your basic training in 1939. And then 1942, November, you went to Algeria. When you arrived in Algeria, where were you going?
Into Tunisia.
Highlands and valleys southwest of Tunis, full of spring flowers, glowing in the sunshine, at peace. But in 1943, this was the scene of bitter fighting between the British Army's Irish Brigade and forces of the Axis powers. It was a place of sacrifice and of suffering.
The Irish Brigade called this place Grandstand Hill. They held it for two bloody months in early 1943. I am Richard O'Sullivan, and this is the first part of All My Brothers, the story of the Irish Brigade in the Second World War.
London, August 1939. Edmund O'Sullivan was working at Hawkes, a Savile Row tailor, when the conversation turned to current affairs.
Mr. Harris said, "Just mark my words, you will see Germany sign a pact with Russia." We laughed at him, but he was right. The German-Soviet pact was signed in Moscow later that month.
Edmund O'Sullivan was 20 years of age, and had been working at Hawkes since he left school in 1934. He was called Dickie by his family because he was skinny, but his friends called him Ted. Ted's father was also named Edmund. He was a railway worker born in Rotherhithe in southeast London. Ted's great-grandfather, Daniel O'Sullivan, had fled the Irish famine and arrived in London in the late 1840s. His mother, Lizzie, was born in Camberwell in south London. Her father, John Hanlon, came from Tralee in County Kerry. Lizzie's mother was a Londoner of Irish descent. Lizzie and Edmund were married in Camberwell in May 1914, 2 months before the start of the First World War. Their marriage was to last 65 years and produce 7 children, 5 boys and 2 girls. Ted O'Sullivan won a scholarship at the age of 11 to the Catholic Brompton Oratory. He was bright, but left school because of money worries and the fear of a sadistic head teacher.
This is 125 Shakespeare Road in Herne Hill. In 1939, Ted and his family were staying in a ground floor flat here. There were 9 of them.
The Great Depression, which began with the Wall Street crash in 1929, was coming to an end. But new threats emerged. German Chancellor Adolf Hitler ordered the reoccupation of the Rhineland in 1936. In March 1938, Austria was absorbed into the Third Reich. At a conference in Munich at the end of September 1938, Germany was awarded the Sudetenland areas of Czechoslovakia. The following March, it broke the terms of the Munich Agreement and took over most of the rest of Czechoslovakia. Britain and France responded by guaranteeing the sovereignty of Poland against German aggression. 2 months later, the UK reintroduced conscription for men 20 to 21 years of age. On the 1st of September 1939, Germany invaded Poland. 2 days later, Britain and France declared war.
Across the road is Corpus Christi Roman Catholic Church in Brixton Hill. Ted and his family attended church here, and it was on September the 3rd, 1939, that Ted heard that war had been declared.
I was at the 10:30 Mass. After the Gospel, Father Kelly gave his usual sermon. Slightly louder than normal, he read to us the announcement that the Prime Minister had made over the radio that morning. We left the church at just after 11:30. We were at war, but it felt no different than the day before.
Soon after, Ted was informed that he was to join the London Irish Rifles, a territorial army unit based in Chelsea.
I'm standing outside Liverpool Street Station in the centre of London, in front of the statue to the refugee children who came from Nazi-oppressed Germany in 1938-39. It was here in October the 18th, 1939, that my father, Edmund O'Sullivan, Ted O'Sullivan, came to join as a conscript London Irish Rifles.
Ted was one of 96 conscripted into the London Irish Rifles 2nd Battalion on Wednesday, 18th of October, 1939. Another was Eddie Mayo, a car worker from Dagenham. He was to be the battalion star recruit and one of Ted's closest friends. Charles Ward, a newspaper print worker, was in the same intake.
They were a mixture of all sorts of people from different walks of life.
You did all the basic training, and that's when you met, you dealt with my father, because he joined the same day.
Yes.
How do you remember, what do you remember about Ted O'Sullivan or Rosie? Do you remember anything about him? Or was it all stuff that you have to edit out?
No, I can remember the initial training we did was we were billeted in Barker Sports Ground next to Wimbledon Tennis Courts, and we slept on the floor. And I remember the first night there was so much noise going on that people couldn't get to sleep, and they were chatting to one another, talking to one another, and I can remember Rosie O'Sullivan chatted to me, and I've since discovered that in the book he wrote he thought I was all right.
While Ted O'Sullivan, Eddie Mayo and Charles Ward were being trained, the war was going badly. Poland had been swiftly defeated and occupied by Germany and the Soviet Union. Denmark and Norway were conquered in the spring of 1940. In May, France was invaded, and in June was sued for peace. Most of the British army escaped from Dunkirk. The Battle of Britain between the RAF and the Luftwaffe was followed by nighttime bombing of London and other British cities. U-boats sank merchant ships, bringing vital supplies to the UK. Winston Churchill became Prime Minister in May 1940. In stirring speeches, he said Britain would never surrender. Italy's dictator, Mussolini, declared war on Britain and her allies in June 1940 and tried to seize Egypt. But everything changed when Germany invaded the Soviet Union on the 22nd of June 1941. Britain was no longer alone. In December 1941, Hitler declared war on the United States of America following Japan's attack on Pearl Harbor. Countries right across Southeast Asia would quickly fall to the Japanese army. Then came the Allies' first victory. In November 1942, Erwin Rommel's Africa Corps was defeated at El Alamein in Egypt. Earlier in 1942, the British government had made a decision that was to change the lives of Ted O'Sullivan and his comrades.
We're just across the road from 10 Downing Street. In October 1941, Winston Churchill had been Prime Minister for 17 months. The war was going terribly. But in that month, Winston Churchill asked for the creation of an Irish Brigade.
The Northern Irish government feared it would inspire Irish nationalism in the six counties of the island of Ireland that was still in the UK. These worries were dismissed and the brigade started to assemble in January 1942 in Norfolk. It comprised three infantry battalions, each with about 800 men. The 1st Battalion of the Royal Irish Fusiliers was a regular army battalion that had fought in France in 1940. They were known as the Fogs, after the Irish war cry, "Fog a Bolla," clear the way. The 6th Battalion of the Royal Inniskilling Fusiliers was known as the Skins, because the regiment had fought a battle during the Napoleonic War, stark naked, after they were surprised by French cavalry when swimming in a river. When it was created, most of the brigade was Irish-born or of Irish descent. All those from the island and Ireland were volunteers. A 26-county Irish Free State had been created in 1922, and Ireland would stay neutral throughout the war. Irish Prime Minister Éamon de Valera had led the Irish Republican Army during the War of Independence. He didn't want any Irish involvement in the conflict. But Churchill's idea struck a chord. It helped bolster support for Britain in the United States and increase volunteer recruitment from both sides of the Irish border. Many British Army commanders also had Irish connections. Bernard Montgomery's family came from Donegal. Harold Alexander's came from Tyrone. Tens of thousands of Irish men and women volunteered to serve in the British Armed Forces or worked in British war industries. In 1942, Britain and the United States decided to go on to the offensive. They chose French North Africa for the first major Anglo-American campaign. The landings were planned for November 1942.
President Roosevelt had created the plan. Prime Minister Churchill heartily endorsed it. And together, in the dark days of late 1941, the two Allied leaders discussed their strategy. To General George Marshall had gone the job of preparing the operations. And in England in April, he completed arrangements with Britain's Prime Minister. Dwight Eisenhower, now Lieutenant General, became commander of the new European theater. Eastward from America, moving silently to their rendezvous. Southward from England, 850 ships in synchronization more vast than any ever before attempted, under an umbrella of protecting carrier-based aircraft, one part to the Mediterranean coast near Algiers and Oran, waiting for the moment of attack, one part remaining behind, off Casablanca, until along the whole North African coastline, the Allies can strike simultaneously.
The aim was to trap German and Italian forces retreating from Egypt. The Allies hoped that French armies based in Morocco, Algeria, and Tunisia would change sides once the landing started. The views of Arab and Berber people in those three countries were ignored.
What was the political situation in Tunisia from a Tunisian perspective before the Allied campaign started in North Africa in November 1942?
To answer that question, you have to go back to a time a little bit before the Allied landings. Tunisia was experiencing a severe slump in political activity. Tunisians had mounted an insurrection involving street protests for more rights, known as the events of the 9th of April 1938. This involved the Parti d'Estourien, the most prominent political party in Tunisia at the time, under the leadership of Habib Bourguiba. This led to a very strong repression by the authorities of the French protectorate of that time. After the banning of the Parti d'Estourien and the imprisonment of the leaders of the party, with Bourguiba at its head, political life in Tunisia became very depressed. The events of the war changed nothing significant except to create the feeling that the debacle of June 1940, when France capitulated to Germany, was a punishment inflicted on France.
Some French forces resisted the Allied landings, but by the 10th of November, most had joined the Allies. They included Moroccan, Algerian and Tunisian soldiers, known as Goumier. They were to fight in the Allied cause until the end of the war. The Allies wanted to capture Tunis before the Germans and Italians could respond. A force of two divisions of the 1st Army began the 500-mile journey from Algiers. It was impeded by bad roads and winter rains, but found itself only 20 miles from Tunis on the 26th of November 1942. The Germans had completely occupied Vichy France on the 10th of November. Hitler then sent troops to Tunisia by air and sea. By early December, the advance of the Anglo-American forces had been repulsed. Hopes of a quick victory had been dashed. The Skins and the London Irish Rifles had sailed from Scotland on the 11th of November and landed at Algiers 10 days later. They travelled by rail to Bejaia. From there, the London Irish went by road to Constantine. The Skins sailed further up the coast to Annaba. The Fogs sailed from Liverpool to Bejaia on the 22nd of November and made the rest of journey by road to join the Skins and the London Irish around Gubala.
This is Gubala, 40 miles southwest of Tunis. At the end of December 1942, all three battalions of the Irish Brigade were based in this area. The weather was terrible. They didn't know where the Germans were, but they soon found out.
In the last 2 weeks of 1942, this is where the Irish Brigade faced its first hard lesson in warfare. All three battalions sent out long-distance patrols to locate enemy positions and suffered casualties during this period. Camped out on the muddy Gublat Plain, the Irish Brigade also had to deal with supply shortages as the Allies struggled to support frontline troops.
Winter rains had replaced summer drought with a vengeance. We found boxes of rations had been broached and the more attractive items of food and cigarettes replaced by a half brick. This felony was compounded by the thought that sailors had risked their lives to bring half bricks thousands of miles to be dumped in the hills of Tunisia. The absence of comforts was to be a trial, and it would be months before fresh food and bread would replace the eternal hard tack.
The Fogs, under the command of Lieutenant Colonel Pat Scott, were involved in the brigade's first serious encounter with the Germans to the east of Gubala. The London Irish were also soon in action.
I'm standing on the road connecting Gubala to the north with Buerada, about 6 miles to the south through that line of hills. At the start of January 1943, this road was effectively the front line between German forces to the east of the road and the Irish Brigade over to the west. This was the scene of the first encounter between the London Irish Rifles and German forces. It would prove to be a painful experience.
Two companies were sent to rescue 8 tanks of the Lothian and Border Horse that had got bogged down in the mud on both sides of the road and to take farmhouses held by German paratroopers. London Irishmen were picked off by snipers and machine gun fire. The battalion suffered 17 casualties, 5 men being killed, including Lance Sergeant John Hogan, a 39-year-old former Irish Guardsman. The wireless set and an aerial on his back had made him an obvious target. On the following day, the Skins moved down the road to Buerada and relieved the Rifle Brigade on Grandstand Hill, which commands views across the Gubalat Plain.
I'm standing on the crest of what the Irish Brigade called Grandstand Hill, and you can see why. The views are excellent.
The Allied commanders were impatient and ordered the Skins to recapture areas of high ground about a mile to the east of Grandstand. The key target was Two Tree Hill. The Skins were supported by 3 Grant tanks from the 17th 21st Lancers and by artillery. Their advance started in darkness at 5:45 in the morning on the 13th of January 1943. It had rained all night, and the ground was sodden. The skins floundered in the mud.
I'm now standing on the path that the skins took on the morning of 13th of January 1943 as they prepared their attack on three high points, including Two Tree Hill.
It was 7 o'clock and broad daylight by the time they were ready to attack the hills. Alerted by the noise of the tanks and carriers, a large force of Germans was ready to meet them.
Right behind me is Two Tree Hill, the principal objective of the skins' attack on the morning of 13th of January 1943.
Struggling up the hill, burdened by equipment, lacking cover and facing seasoned German defenders, the skins lost more than 90 men killed, wounded or taken prisoner. That's around 20% of the number that set off that morning. All three Grants were knocked out by German 88mm guns. After 5 hours fighting, the skins withdrew to Grandstand. The Irish Brigade as a whole was then ordered to try and take Two Tree Hill. The attack was planned for the 19th of January, but the Germans launched their own attack the previous morning. About 20 Panzer tanks, supported by three infantry battalions, headed for Grandstand and the Gubelat Road beyond. Panzers advanced west along the southern road to Burrada, which was held by the French, but the Allies were ready. More than 70 artillery pieces hammered the Germans attacking the skins on Grandstand. Two companies of the Foggs were sent to help the skins.
I'm standing on the western slopes of Grandstand Hill, where the Germans launched their surprise attack on Irish Brigade positions on the morning of 18th of January 1943.
Commanding A Company was Major Peter Murphy, who had been awarded a military cross for bravery during the retreat to Dunkirk in 1940. He now led his men in a bayonet charge across Grandstand's eastern slopes. He was shot and killed along with one of the Foggs' pipers right beside him. His second in command was blinded. The Germans had been repulsed, but more than 50 more members of the brigade had been killed and wounded. The Foggs and the skins had suffered the most so far. The London Irish would face the next onslaught. The battalion had moved to Ellerussa and marched in daylight through Burrada to near to Grandstand on the 19th of January.
I read a bit from my diary. On Tuesday, January the 19th, we got orders to move at 11:30 to take up positions near the skins. We moved onto a plane through Burrada and got mortared to hell. I managed to dive into a wadi, but one landed and Stan got hit bad. Don't think he'll pull through. Connery and Ted also hit, but will survive. Mr. Hardwick hit, made his own way out. Continued and took a position on hill and dug in.
That night, the London Irish was ordered to launch a dawn attack on this ridge about a mile south of Grandstand. Its two high points were Hill 279 and Hill 286. The London Irish crossed the start line on the Gubelat to Burrada Road at 5 a.m. There was no preparatory artillery bombardment. Hill 279 was taken within 15 minutes.
I'm now on Point 279, which F and G companies of the London Irish Rifle took on the morning of 20th of January 1943. Their next objective behind me was Point 286.
By the end of the morning, the London Irish had taken 286, but they found themselves in an impossible position.
I'm now on Point 286, which the London Irish Rifles took on the morning of 20th of January 1943. The position was almost indefensible. The battalion took massive casualties.
Wednesday, January the 20th. We went in to take Hill in early hours. Moved forward with 13 and 15 forward, 14 in reserve. First hill clear, second hill clear. Third hill, all hell let loose. 14 platoon and a few odds and ends drew back into hollow. I moved out to help other company take hill. Reached top, driven back by tanks into hollow. We were mortared in hollow for hours. One dropped in own mortar pit. Corporal Howe and three others caught him. Another dropped near and Blair got a piece in his back. Got injured out and got artillery to lay smoke screen, then all dashed out back to Wadi. Checked up on strength of approximately 30 men left in the company. Other companies went forward to hold position on First Hill. Our company slept in Wadi.
Colour Sergeant Ten O'Sullivan at the supply base in Alarusa had no idea what was happening.
Our normal convoy was prepared that afternoon, and we made our way to where the battalion was situated. I discovered what remained of E Company on point 279. There was no company commander, and the second in command, Captain Joseph Carrigan, had been killed. Lieutenant Rawlings and Billy Allen, a sergeant and two lance sergeants, had been wounded and evacuated. An officer had refused to advance and was under arrest, as was a senior NCO. It was a shambles.
Thursday, January the 21st, 00:30 hours, hell let loose again. Attacked by tanks, supported by infantry. We were caught entirely by surprise and scattered. I made off with Terry in direction of Buarada. Machine gun fire all along top of Wadi. Got out and crossed road into ploughed field and ran like hell. Trace of flying everywhere, especially to our right and left, into farms where 25 pounders were. Walked a long road to Alarusa and picked up by water truck and arrived at A Echelon. That night, I reported back to battalion and the company was less than the platoon strong. It was horrendous.
The Germans launched a devastating attack on London Irish positions on point 286 and 279. The battalion withdrew in disarray to this point.
The FOG's commanding officer, Pat Scott, moved an armoured car to the Gublat Buarada Road to block the Germans, who withdrew almost as quickly as they arrived. But more than 250 London Irish had been killed, wounded, captured or gone missing. That was more than half of those who set off from the start line on the 20th of January. This is a German photograph of London Irish riflemen taken prisoner during the battles around Buarada in January 1943. Events on hills 279 and 286 were a crushing blow to the morale of the London Irish Rifles. The net was closing in on General Erwin Rommel's Africa Corps, which was retreating from Libya, and the Axis forces in Tunisia. In February, they launched a counterstroke through these mountain passes to the south of Buarada. The aim was to stop Allied forces in the west, linking up with the 8th Army coming through Libya. The American Army was mauled at Kasserim Pass. But the Allies' growing strength was beginning to tell. The final German attempt to break the noose closing around them was launched on the evening of the 25th of February. It was called Operation Ox's Head. At the end of February, the Irish Brigade was holding Grandstand and this mile-long ridge west of the Gublat to Buarada Road. It was named Stuka Ridge because of the number of air attacks that it experienced. The main strong point here was Stuka Farm.
The Irish Brigade called this place Stuka Ridge. It was held by the London Irish Rifles in February 1943.
Half the FOGs were in reserve near Jalida, a railway stop between Buarada and Alarusa. The rest of the Irish Brigade was in Grandstand and in support of the London Irish south of Stuka Ridge.
The men who now comprised most of E Company were poorly trained and not a patch on their predecessors. One early morning, I inspected the forward position of 7th Platoon. It was dark and raining, and I searched for the two sentries of one section. I saw a Bren gun muzzle poking out from a pile of blankets and ground sheets. After removing a couple of layers, a voice shouted, "Halt! Who goes there?" I rebuked him and said, "If I'd been a German, you'd be dead."
On the night of 25th of February, the Germans crossed the Gublat to Buarada Road and pushed west into the battalion's positions. The attack was spearheaded by paratroopers. Ted O'Sullivan was delivering rations to platoons on the ridge and surrounding high points at dawn the next day when it began. Captain Strome Galloway, a Canadian officer posted to F Company of the London Irish Rifles, was an eyewitness to the fighting around Stuka Farm.
"The Boche started throwing mortar bombs among our own group, and we suffered 4 men killed and 2 wounded. The 2 men I was lying between were both hit, and huge chunks of shrapnel whizzed through the air just above me. The enemy machine gun fire was continuous. A platoon of Royal Irish Fusiliers and 6 Churchill tanks of the Lothian Border Horse counterattacked. They withdrew again, for what reason I do not know. I got through on the wireless and said I was leaving the farm for the cactus patch behind it, not because the enemy was pushing me out, but because our own artillery was going to shell me to cover their counterattack. We then broke cover and dashed across the plateau and down the reverse slope into the cactus patch just as the Fusiliers appeared on the scene. This attack was swept forward unopposed, moved through the previously overrun forward positions and restored the situation. The enemy fled into the wadis on the plain. Our 3-inch mortars got in some fine shooting."
The London Irish was driven off parts of Stuka Ridge, but held Stuka Farm and a high point which was known as Castle Hill. At 11 o'clock, reinforcements arrived. By the evening, the Irish Brigade had retaken the ridge. German tanks storming south on the road west of Jebel Rehan were repulsed by the 28th of February. By the 7th of March, Operation Ox's Head was over. The final effort to break the Allied armies had failed. The Irish Brigade had held out, but it lost many more men. The London Irish had been so badly mauled that some suggested it should be dissolved. This was resisted, but its commanding officer was replaced by Pat Scott.
The Battle for Stuka Ridge was the last significant engagement for the Irish Brigade in the Boer Rada area. By the middle of March, all 3 battalions were transferred to the Bijar area in the northwest, where an entirely new chapter of the Irish Brigade story was written.
So after Stuka Ridge, the London Irish Rifles were withdrawn for rest and reinforcement. And during the training period there, that's when you injured your knee, or knee got worse. And then your career took a different direction. You eventually were retrained to work with the SOE.
Yes.
And you had met Margaret in Algeria. She, by chance, also came to Bari. And that's where you proposed.
Yes.
And you both, that's you and Margaret, got married in South West London of 9th of March 1946. That's more than 72 years ago now. And you have had 4 children. You have 10 grandchildren and 14 great-grandchildren.
Yeah. Wonderful.